Divorcing a Narcissist.
To divorcing a narcissist has 7 steps. The first one is hire a great attorney. The second one, have an exit strategy. Number 3, document everything. Number 4, prepare for character assassination. Number 5, prepare for their financial lies. Number 6, prepare for drama during custody exchanges. And number 7, expect parental alienation. All right, now let's get into all of these. The first one, hire a great attorney. I knew that for me, attorney. I interviewed countless attorneys. And I remember when I saw Sylvia Kirk, and I hope you look her up. If you're in Colorado and you need a bulldog who is fair, doesn't rip you off, and is smart as hell, and works her tail off, and is gifted in the courtroom, look for Sylvia Kirk. She was a bulldog, and you need that. Now, she also had the ability to try and work compromise. So you don't want just a bulldog that's going to drain your bank account and fight over everything. She picked her battles. She knew what to look for. And so you go in with a list of questions of what it is you're looking for from an attorney, and you don't stop until you find that. All right, so educate yourself on what it is. Right. Number 2, have an exit strategy. This means make copies of all the documents, life insurance policy, bank accounts, any financial aspect of your relationship before you leave. You get all of that printed off, and you find the passwords to everything. If they're online accounts, you print everything off online because they're going to hide money and steal money. You need to know an accurate assessment of where everything is financially. So you need to copy any and all financial documents. You also, before you leave, need to set up your own bank accounts, have a place to stay, and friends who are willing to help you make the move and set everything. I had to do that. I had a business, and I was so shame-based, and so I just didn't know how to be a man, that I let her take control of all the finances. And you know, she was a stay-at-home mom. What's she doing running the business financially? It was just crazy. I just didn't know how to stand up for myself. And she was destroying my credit and everything. And I was complaining. I was playing the victim to my counselor. And he just said, Kenny, what can you control? And so that's why I was offered those 3 questions. What do you want? What can you control? What won't you tolerate? Well, I couldn't tolerate her stealing money and hiding money, destroying my credit. What did I want? I wanted control over my stuff. I didn't want to take money from her, but I didn't want her to have...
Oh, yeah, well, let's do that too, because I'm going to see a lawyer today. I want you to put it on there so I can record that too. Put it out there. You giving everything I need. Thank you. Going to see the lawyer at 4. Yes. Yes, I got so much shit to show him. Acting like you're a good person. Ain't nothing good about you. Never was. Came into this marriage wanting to come up. That's all it was.
Number 3, document everything. Use text and email as much as possible. Stay off the phone. It's also incredibly important that you compile school and medical records for your children. In my divorce, she was so great at convincing everyone what a terrible person I was. The initial child and family investigator came back and completely threw me under the bus. I virtually never got to see my kids, no decision making, nothing. She had convinced them I was the devil incarnate. And I was devastated. But thank God she's a narcissist. And since she kept losing in court because she wanted all this money and everything, I focused on what I can control. And I started noticing that whenever the kids were in her care, they were late to school. Also, we were getting these letters from the state saying, your kid's about to be held back because they're not getting to school enough. Every single one of the lates and every single one of the missed days at school were while they were in her care. And see, that's why you document everything and you don't fight every battle. You wait, you pile it up. And so I went back to the child and family investigator and I said, look, oh, that was another thing. I kept trying to schedule surgeries and she'd cancel them. Like, she just needed control over everything. So I piled it all up and I went back to the CFI and I said, hey, there's some things going on. I'm just wondering if you'd be willing to relook at things. Well, when my lawyer called me and said, Kenny, in my almost 30 years of doing this, I have never seen a child and family investigator switch and say that their original report was wrong. He completely flipped everything and pointed out that she was doing parental alienation. And see, that's the thing. That's why you pick your battles. And you got to be patient. And you got to document everything because they will expose themselves. And so if you do this the right way, you can win. And that's what happened. prepare for character assassination. As I said, they will assassinate everything about you. So it's imperative that you get affidavits from friends, colleagues, companies you've worked for in the past. But more importantly, judges don't care about what your friends think about you. They care about your actions. Get your rear end into counseling, into parenting classes. You need to show that you are working on yourself, that you are serious about all of this. It is all about your actions. Now, I was doing all of that, but I still got barbecued the first time, but I stuck with it. And but when it all turned around, it was because I did the right thing. I stuck with it. I created a track record of my progress and all the work I was doing. And the CFI completely changed his tune and admitted his mistakes. And that's why it's imperative that you put a plan in place to grow yourself and you do actions, not words, all right?
This man didn't even want Amora. He wanted me to have an abortion. I had Amora. You think he around here helping me now? No. And then people be like, oh, he be.
Number five, prepare for the financial lies. This is hysterical. They're going to make incredibly grandiose demands. Tremendous money, or they're going to say, oh, I'm so broke. All right. So if, you know, one of them was the primary provider, they're going to hide their finances. They're going to lie about how much they made. That's why you have to get all the documents beforehand. So when they start hiding everything, if they, you know, were a stay-at-home mom or dad, they're going to, like, she never did the laundry. I always did the laundry.
They said the disc was corrupt, that the financial wasn't on there. So now we updated the disc. We checked it. Everything is right. She has the financials now. She's posting my information out to the internet. She sent some stuff to my daughter about the financials. So we know she got that.
Yeah, we know she got it. She should have had it the first time. We don't know what happened to that disc. It was missing in action. At first, she said she didn't get anything. And then she waited all this long time.
Sign papers. That's all I ask, man. You know what I'm saying? I want to move on with my life. I got so many big things that I'm working on, and I just want you to sign the papers, man. I signed the papers last year. You understand? What we waiting on? Sign the papers, please. Free me.
Number six, plan for drama during custody exchanges. They will demand all these rules, but they will never follow them. And if you deviate at all, they're going to throw a conniption. They will. It doesn't matter what the court documents say, they will break them. We had a decision maker. Because she just wouldn't do anything. So we literally, for anything, do you want to take the kids to the park? We'd have to call the decision maker. Like, she would throw a fit that I wanted to take the kids to the park. So I couldn't take the kids to the park until we called the decision maker. It's just unbearable. But that may be what you need, because this is who you're dealing with. And so they will hide the kids. They will not show up. They'll change the schedule to convince the kids not to see you. And so most often, you're probably going to have to hire a decision maker or a civil assist for exchanges, depending on the type of narcissist and the way they like to abuse you. Again, you're not dealing with a rational person here. You can't negotiate. You can't have discussions. And so you need to put a plan in place to protect yourself. All right? Parental alienation. This is, you can't escape this. They are going to poison your kids and turn them against you and say incredibly awful things. They're going to give all the details of the divorce, slanted in a direction that makes them the hero and you the villain. You don't want to fight that. You don't want to counter it and tell your kids the truth, because now you've just alienated them. Alienation is whenever we disparage the other parent. Now, I know you think it's right to tell them the truth, but that's why I always say with all of these topics, go become an expert, because that's not the expert way to handle this. Kids need stability. They need to see a mom or at least one parent who knows how to handle a toxic person. And if you react with toxicity, how are your kids ever going to get through this? So it's imperative that you go become an expert in parental alienation.
Not gonna work.
Right.
What is one of the things that sets us off in a bad direction as we start to co-parent?
I mean, I definitely feel like it's a lot of emotions involved if they can't maintain a relationship with the father of the child.
Yeah.
But we have to always understand it's about the best interest of the child, no matter what, mm-hmm. no matter how that relationship ended. It's all about the child.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the child didn't ask to be here, and children need to have their father and their mother.
Yeah.
You know, love from both, and it should be no tearing each other down. The father shouldn't talk bad about the mother. The mother shouldn't talk bad about the father.
Mm-hmm.
That image should always be perfect, and let the child.
She's hurt. And I was hurt too. And she was doing the best she could. And it's really sad that her pain has caused her to be that far out of touch with reality that she thought her demands were reasonable. That's sad. And I think we need to remember that. I don't condone their actions. But if we can't have empathy for their pain, we need to do some work on ourselves.